Okay, good afternoon, all of you. We are all safe in Vizag. Don't worry about Vizag people. Most of the people, they are safe. Okay, next. Today, we are going to discuss about the most important topic. You see here this picture. It is an expression with the help of the an important structure. And here also you see another structure, another expression that is also with the help of the another same structure. And here you see this is the picture it is showing the another function of the today's lecture or call. And I think all of you missed this season. ఏ ఇలా వచ్చింది మనకు కనిపించాలి కదా స్లైడ్స్ ఓకే ఓకే నెక్స్ట్ హియర్ యూ సీ ఈస్ షోయింగ్ గమ్ అండ్ దిస్ ఆల్సో దిస్ ఫంక్షన్ ఇస్ ఆల్సో పర్ఫార్మ్ బై ద ఇంపార్టెంట్ ఆర్గాన్ నెక్స్ట్ యూ సీ హియర్ ఇస్ ద ఆర్ స్టేట్ లీడర్ And now he is in the vice president. That is, he is also speaker to the Rajya Sabha. Okay, he is also giving his speech with the help of the most important organ. I think all of you know what is the organ. That is nothing but the tongue. Here, what are the different functions of the tongue? That is for speaking, for chewing, for licking. For speech, all these functions are performed with the help of the tongue only. What is tongue? Tongue is a conical muscular organ covered with partially with mucous membrane and lies partly in the oral cavity and partly in the pharynx. That is the location of the tongue. It is a solid conical muscular organ. It is purely it is filled with the muscles and in between muscles there are glands. All these things, okay, and it is lined by mucous membrane. It is lined by mucous membrane, and it lies in the oral cavity. That is partly in the oral cavity and partly in the pharynx. Next, what are the parts of the tongue? Tongue, it is having different parts. That is, first one is the apex. Next is the base. Next, dorsal surface, inferior surface, and two lateral margins. And root. These are all the parts of the tongue. That is, first one is the tip of the tongue, what you are seeing in front, and base of the tongue, the below, and the dorsal surface. That is the surface, upper surface, or inferior surface, and inferior surface, and two lateral margins and root of the tongue. These are all the parts of the tongue. You see here, this is the tip of the tongue, and this is the base or root of the tongue, and these are the margins. These are the margins of the tongue. What you are seeing, this is the dorsal surface, and below that there is an inferior surface. Next, the tip is directed forwards and in contact with the incisor teeth. The tip is directed forwards in contact with the tip of the incisor teeth. These teeth are called incisor teeth. And base is directed backwards towards oropharynx. It is connected to the epiglottis by median and a pair of lateral glasso-epiglottic folds. Here there are folds of mucous membrane. They are connecting the posterior part or base of the tongue to the an important structure that is called epiglottis. And in between the epiglottis and the tongue, that is tongue, we also call it as glossus. Okay, that is why glasso-epiglottic folds. In between the epiglottis and tongue, there are three folds. That is, one is in the midline, and another two are the in the both the sides of the midline. They are called glasso-epiglottic folds. On each side of the median fold presents epiglottic valacula. Epiglottic valacula. Okay, and this part here, what you are seeing, you see here, this is the dorsal surface of the tongue and this is the base of the tongue. It is connected with the, this is called epiglottis. Okay, in between the tongue and the epiglottis, there are three folds. This is the median fold. This is the median glasso-epiglottic fold. And this is the one lateral glasso-epiglottic fold. This is another lateral glasso-epiglottic fold. Okay, in between these folds, here this space is called valacula. This space is called valacula. And here, that is epiglottic valacula. That is called epiglottic valacula. Next, dorsal surface of the tongue. Convex all sides. Dorsal surface of the tongue is convex all sides and is covered with the mucous membrane. The covering of the tongue, the dorsal surface covering of the tongue is called mucous membrane. And this surface is divided into anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third by a V-shaped structure that is called sulcus terminalis. Sulcus terminalis, it divides the tongue into anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third. That is the importance of the sulcus terminalis. That is, with the help of the sulcus terminalis, the dorsal surface of the tongue is divided into two parts, that is anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third. The sulcus passes forwards and laterally from a central depression that is called foramen cecum. Foramen cecum. This foramen cecum, you can see here, this is the V-shaped sulcus terminalis. Okay, depression, sulcus terminalis, and here it is V-shaped, and at the this junction point of the V, here you see a small depression, and this is called foramen cecum. Foramen cecum, this foramen cecum, it is nothing but the remaining part of the thyroglossal duct. Thyroglossal duct, and what is thyroglossal duct, we see later. Okay, and during the embryonic development, it is an important structure. It is helpful for the migration of the thyroid cells from the posterior one-third of the tongue into the thyroid. That is why it is called remnant of the thyroglossal duct. That is nothing but the foramen cecum, which indicates the commencement of the median thyroid rudiment as the thyroglossal duct. Okay, thyroglossal duct. Next, presulcal oral part, the mucous membrane is adherent to the underlying muscles by the lamina propria and is provided with numerous projections. They are called papillae of different types. The papillae are different types. You see here, this is the mucous membrane, and here these are all the papillae. These are all the, this is, these are the fungiform papillae, and there is a filiform papillae. And these are called big papillae. They are called circumvallate papillae. Circumvallate papillae. Why they are called circumvallate? Why they are called fungiform? Why they are called filiform? All these things we discuss later. Okay. And here again, you see here. You see, these are the, this is the mucous membrane of the tongue. Here, these are the papillae. These are all the papillae, and here this is the attachment between the mucous membrane and the muscles of the tongue. Okay, this is the lamina propria. Lamina propria. Okay, that is the different types of papillae. We see what are the different types of papillae now. Okay, the under the on the dorsal surface of the tongue, there are four types of papillae are present. That is, first one is the circumvallate papillae, fungiform papillae, foliate papillae, and filiform papillae. Out of these, circumvallate, fungiform, and filiform papillae are present in the human beings, and foliate papillae mostly they are present in the animals. That is, especially rabbit like that animals they present. We see in detail about the each papillae. First, you see about the circumvallate papillae. This is very important because it bears the taste buds. These are 8 to 12 in number and arranged in a V-shaped single row, immediately in front and parallel to sulcus terminalis. Just now we had seen sulcus terminalis. You see here also, you can see. And this is the dorsum of the tongue. And here this is the sulcus terminalis, and this is the foramen cecum, and these are all the circumvallate papillae. They are also arranged V-shape just in front of the sulcus terminalis. These are all the papillae. Okay, they are 8 to 12 in number. 8 to 12 in number. And why they are called circumvallate? That is also very, very important. Because they are surrounded by a trench or groove. There's, you see here, this is not the burger. Okay, it is a circumvallate papillae. And here, this is the papillae. Surrounding this papillae, this is the margin or wall of the papillae. And in between these two, there is a trench or groove. This is because of presence of this one. These papillae, they are called circumvallate papillae. Just like if you go to the forts, any forts in our country, they are surrounded by a groove, trench. Within the trench, they used to, surrounding this, there is a wall, big wall is there. And within the trench, there are they store the water and they leave the crocodiles in the trench to protect from the enemies. Okay, just like that, here, there is a trench. This is called circumvallate papillae. This is the microscopic structure of the circumvallate papillae, and the walls of the sulcus presents taste buds. Taste buds are present in the wall of the circumvallate papillae, and its bottom receives ducts of the serous glands. Here in the walls there are taste buds, and they are also receiving the, at the bottom they are receiving the serous glands. There is a link between the taste buds and the serous glands, because if you take food, it must be dissolved in the some liquid, then only the taste buds are able to taste the substance. Because of this reason, the serous glands, they open at the bottom of the trench, and the taste buds open into the trench. That is why there is a appreciation of taste is possible. The outer wall of the sulcus is known as vallum. Here you see, this is the section of the circumvallate papillae. Here this is the papilla. Okay, surrounding this, this is the sulcus. Okay, here this is the wall of the papilla. This is the outer covering of the papilla. And here these are the taste buds. These are the taste buds. They are responsible for the taste sensation. Okay, and again you can see here, this is the serous gland. It opens through the duct, it opens into the base of the trench. So it pours its secretions whenever there is a need for the taste. That is, if you want to appreciate the taste, there is a stimulation of these glands and they pour their secretions into the trench and they dissolve the food substance. And these are the taste buds. They are able to appreciate the taste. Okay, this is the microscopic structure of the taste bud. This is the microscopic structure of the taste bud. And this is the gustatory pore, and this is the area the food comes in contact with the taste cells. That is, it is having nerve cells, okay, nerve fibers, and that is called receptor cells. And this is the outer covering is called sheath cells, and these are the supporting cells, and these are the basal cells. Whenever there is a loss of these cells, it is replaced by the basal cells. This is the structure of the taste bud. The taste buds are composed of modified epithelial cells. That is, the taste buds, the cells are nothing but the modified epithelial cells. These are spherical masses with the epithelial covering the tongue, and within the tongue epithelium, an inferior surface of the soft palate, palatoglossal arches, posterior surface of the epiglottis, and posterior wall of the pharynx. These are all the sites for the taste buds. Where they are located? That is, the first one is the within the epithelium of the tongue, an inferior surface of the soft palate, palatoglossal arches, posterior surface of the epiglottis, and the posterior wall of the pharynx. These are all the structures they are having taste buds. They are numerous on the sides of the palate papillae, but they may be present on the all these areas, but they are more concentrated at the palate papillae. That is the location of the taste buds. Each taste bud is made up of slender spindle-shaped pale cells, some of which are gustatory sensory cells. Gustation means taste. Sensory cells, and others are supporting cells. Functionally, there are four types of subjective taste, that is, taste sensations. I think the physiology, sir is very well explained about the taste, all these physiology of the taste. Here, basically, there are four types of taste. They are appreciated by our tongue. That is, the first one is the sweet and salt, that is at the tip of the tongue. You can appreciate the sweet and salt taste with the help of the tip of the tongue, and sour at the sides. Sour, that is nothing but the acid taste, that is at the sides of the tongue, and bitter is in the pharyngeal part of the tongue. That is the part, that is the posterior part of the tongue. Okay, with the help of the posterior part of the tongue, we are able to appreciate the bitter taste. With the help of the tip of the tongue, we are able to appreciate the sweet and salt taste. On both sides of the tongue, both sides of the tongue, with the help of the sides of the tongue, we are able to appreciate the sour taste of the sour taste. Okay, next, coming to the another papillae, that is a fungiform papillae. Why it is called fungi? It is fungus like. The shape is like a fungus with the narrow base and broad tip. Okay, that is why they are called fungiform papillae. These are rounded reddish elevations situated discreetly along the sides and tip of the tongue. They are not specifically located, but if you take the circumvallate papillae, they are specifically located along the in front of the sulcus terminalis. But these fungiform papillae, they are not located in a single area. They are discreetly arranged in different parts of the tongue. They contain taste buds. These are modified epithelial cells. They also contain the taste buds. So the fungiform papillae and circumvallate papillae, these are the two papillae. They are provided with taste buds. The taste buds are nothing but the modified epithelial cells of the tongue. Modified epithelial cells of the tongue. Next, another papillae, that is the filiform papillae. Okay, you see, I show you fungiform papillae diagram. You see here, these are all the white. These are white spots. See, this is straightly arranged all over the dorsum of the tongue. These are all nothing but the fungiform papillae. Okay, next is the filiform papillae. These are numerous tiny conical projections affecting the entire dorsal surface of the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. You see here, this is the fungiform papillae, and here you can see within the fungiform papillae, you can see the, you can appreciate the taste buds. Some taste buds are there, and here these are the filiform papillae. There are small conical projections. Next, come to the inferior surface of the tongue. The inferior surface is covered with mucosa devoid of papillae. There is no papillae in the inferior surface of the tongue, the divide of papillae, and it is covered with mucous membrane or mucosa. This surface presents in the center line, there is a one structure that is called frenulum linguae, and plica fimbriata, that is also another fold of mucous membrane on the side of the frenulum, and deep lingual way. Deep lingual way. These are the three important structures. You can see here, this is the central frenulum linguae or frenulus of the tongue, and on the side here you see, this is the plica fimbriata, plica fimbriata, and here in this area there is a vein, that is a dorsal vein of the tongue. Next, the lateral margins covered with mucosa and palatoglossal arch is attached to it. Okay, that is the lateral margins, it is covered with the, that is a mucosa, and the palatoglossal arch, it comes and it attaches to the lateral, on both sides of the tongue, to the lateral margins. Next, coming to the another part, that is the root of the tongue, the part of the tongue attached to the floor of the mouth and extends forwards. Root is formed by lower fibers of the genioglossus muscle. We see later genioglossus muscle, what is genioglossus muscle, all these things in detail. Okay, next coming to the muscles of the tongue. The bulk of the tongue is formed by the muscles, that is superior surface, it is covered by the, that is a mucous membrane, it contains taste buds, and inferior surface is also covered by mucous membrane. In between these two, there are muscles, that is the hyoglossal membrane. It divides the tongue into two parts, that is median fibrous septum. It divides the tongue into two symmetrical halves. Symmetrical half. Each half of the tongue, it contains five important muscles. That is five important extrinsic muscles. The tongue is having two types of muscles. First one is the extrinsic muscles and intrinsic muscles. Extrinsic muscles means they are taking origin from somewhere and they are attached to the tongue. And intrinsic muscles means they are present within the tongue, just like our eyeball. That is intrinsic muscles of the eyeball and extrinsic muscles of the eyeball. Just like that, here also there are intrinsic muscles and extrinsic muscles. The intrinsic muscles of the tongue, you see later. Okay, first you see about the extrinsic muscles. That is extrinsic muscles are five. That is chondroglossus, hyoglossus, palatoglossus, genioglossus, styloglossus, and that indicates the site of origin of the muscle, and they reach the tongue. That is why they are called glosses, and where they are taking origin, that indicates the first part. That is the chondroglossus, hyoglossus from hyoid bone, palatoglossus from the palate, and genioglossus from the genial tubercle, and styloglossus, that is from the tip of the styloid process. And intrinsic muscles also present, there are superior and inferior longitudinal muscles, like this, longitudinal muscles in the, on both sides, superior longitudinal muscle and inferior longitudinal muscle. And transverse muscles, transversely also muscles arranged, and some muscles are vertically arranged. Because of this reason, already we had seen in the histology, if you take the section of the tongue, you can see all the directional muscle fibers, especially the skeletal muscles. The tongue is made up of skeletal muscles. Here you can see, if you take the section of the tongue, you can see multi-directional muscle fibers, skeletal muscle fibers. That is the clear-cut indication of the tongue, to identify the tongue. Here there are superior and inferior longitudinal muscles, transverse linguae, that is the transverse muscles, and vertical linguae, verticalis linguae, that is vertical muscles. These are all the intrinsic muscles. First, we see about the extrinsic muscles of the tongue. Extrinsic muscles alter the position of the tongue. That is the most important function of the extrinsic muscles. That is, they alter the position of the tongue, whereas the intrinsic muscles alter the shape of the tongue. These are the two most important and different functions of the two muscles of the tongue, that is extrinsic muscles and intrinsic muscles. So the intrinsic muscles alter the position of the tongue, and the intrinsic muscles The extrinsic muscles alter the position of the tongue, and intrinsic muscles alter the shape of the tongue. That is the basic function of these muscles. First, you see about the individual muscles in detail. That is the extrinsic muscles. Out of these, the most important muscle, genioglossus. Genioglossus. Why it is called genioglossus? Because it is taking origin from the genial tubercle and the posterior part of the symphysis meatus. The genial tubercle, it is nothing but the small elevation in the posterior part of the symphysis meatus. That is called genial tubercle. From this general, these genial tubercle are four in number, right side to left side, and again superior and inferior. From this superior genial tubercle, the genioglossus muscle, it takes origin and it goes in different directions. We see what are the different fibers of the muscle, and it is a fan shaped muscle and forms the bulk of the tongue. This is the most important muscle. Because it takes part in the formation of the bulk of the muscle, and it takes origin from the superior genial tubercle of the symphysis meatus of the mandible. Next, insertions. The insertion is different, and you see lower fibers are attached to body of the hyoid bone. They are going down, okay, and they are attached to the hyoid bone, and intermediate fibers, they pass deep to the hyoglossus muscle and are continuous with the middle constrictor of the pharynx. Okay, pharynx, what is pharynx? We discuss later. Okay, in the later classes, we discuss about the pharynx. And next, upper fibers turn forward and upward and are inserted into the tongue, extending from the root to the apex. From root to apex, these muscle fibers, the upper fibers of the genioglossus, they are going to the tongue. Okay, here you can see, this is the genioglossus muscle total. Okay, here this is the area symphysis meatus. This is the anterior surface. This is the posterior part of the symphysis meatus. From here, this is the, these are the genial tubercles. This is the inferior and this is the superior. And here, from here, this area, it takes origin. The muscle takes origin. And here it goes, these are the upper fibers. They are going to the tongue, and intermediate fibers, it is, they are going like this, and they are joining with the middle, that is pharynx. And next, the lower fibers, they are going to the hyoid bone. Hyoid. Okay, these are all the different fibers of the genioglossus muscle. Genioglossus muscle. What is the function of the genioglossus muscle? What is the need for the genioglossus muscle? It protrudes the tip of the tongue and makes the dorsal surface concave from side to side. Like this. It protrudes the tongue and it makes the dorsal surface concave from side to side. Like this. Integrity of the action of genioglossus saves the life of the subject by preventing the backward fall of the tongue towards oropharynx. Otherwise, the respiration might be obstructed. Hence, the genioglossus is called safety muscle of the tongue. What is the safety muscle of the tongue? Genioglossus. Why it is important means, suppose if there is a paralysis of the hypoglossum, that is because that is the nerve of the, all the muscles of the motor nerve of the tongue. If there is a paralysis of this muscle, this nerve, because it may be there is a brainstem stroke, it leads to damage to the hypoglossal nerve. If there is a hypoglossal nerve damage, there is a weakness of the muscles of the tongue. If especially the genioglossus muscle, it is because it is a safety muscle, because it prevents the tongue from falling backwards. Okay, that's why it is preventing the obstruction to the respiration, especially in patients who had a stroke. Especially brainstem stroke, there is a chances for the paralysis of the genioglossus muscle. In that individuals, it is difficult to take respiration. That is, it produces obstruction to the respiration. And then we usually put some airway for the to prevent the aspiration and to create the airway clear. You put some airway. If you go to the clinicals, you can observe this clinical condition. But because of this reason, this is called safety muscle. Safety muscle. Next, coming to another muscle, hyoglossus muscle. It is a quadrilateral muscle and arises from the upper surface of the greater cornu and partly from the body of the hyoid. Here, hyoid bone in this area, this is the very important bone because it is providing attachment to the suprahyoid and infrahyoid group of many muscles. And this hyoid bone, it is having three parts, that is a body, greater cornu, lesser cornu, and here our muscle, I show you later. What is the hyoid bone? Show you later. Here, hyoglossus muscle, it takes origin from the greater cornu and body of the hyoid bone, and it is inserted to the sides of the tongue between the styloglossus laterally and inferior longitudinal muscle medially. Okay, in between these two muscles, it gets inserted to the sides of the tongue. Action, it depresses the side of the tongue and makes the dorsal surface convex. It depresses the sides of the tongue, so the tongue becomes like this, convex. Here, genioglossus, it makes the tongue concave, dorsally. Okay, that is the difference between the hyoglossus and genioglossus functions. Next, here, the relations of the hyoglossus muscle is very, very important because it is a partition-like. It is a muscle like a partition on both sides of the tongue. If you want to reach the tongue, you must pass through the hyoglossus muscle. Because of this reason, what are the structures superficial to the or lateral to the hyoglossus muscle, and what are the structures deep to the hyoglossus muscle? There are two hyoglossus muscles like this. Okay, the structures superficial means lateral to the hyoglossus muscle, and the structures medial to the hyoglossus muscle are deep to the hyoglossus muscle. You must have an idea about the what are the structures related with the hyoglossus muscle. First, it is laterally, it is covered by myelohyoid, and below the hyoglossus muscle, the myelohyoid is like this and hyoglossus is like this. In between the hyoglossus and the myelohyoid, this is the part that is the lateral part or superficial part. Between myelohyoid and hyoglossus, these are all the structures. That is, first it is lined by mucous membrane and styloglossus, lingual nerve, and submandibular ganglion, and submandibular duct, and hypoglossal nerve. These are all the structures, they are superficial or lateral to the this hyoglossus muscle. And next, coming to the what are the deep structures, that is inferior longitudinal muscle of the pharynx or tongue, and middle constrictor of the pharynx, second part of the lingual artery, stylopharyngeus, styloglossopharyngeal nerve, and styloid ligament, stylohyoid ligament. These are all the parts. Deep, that is deep to the hyoglossus muscle, that is inferior longitudinal muscle of the tongue, middle constrictor of the pharynx, second part of the lingual artery, stylopharyngeus muscle, glossopharyngeal nerve, and stylohyoid ligament. These are all the structures present deep to the this. Okay, I show you. Okay, you see here. This is the hyoglossus muscle. Hyoglossus muscle, and this is the myelohyoid muscle. And in between the hyoglossus muscle and myelohyoid muscle, these are all the structures present. They are the lateral structures or superficial structures, and it is the deep. Here, these are all the structures present in the deep surface of the relation with the deep surface of the hyoglossus muscle. Okay, this is the very, very important. Okay, next coming to the another muscle, that is styloglossus muscle. Styloglossus. It is called, why it is called styloglossus? From the styloid process of the, at the base of the skull, there is a one prolongation that is called styloid process. From the tip of the styloid process to the side of the tongue, there is a one muscle that is called styloglossus muscle. The muscle arises from the tip of the styloid process and stylomandibular ligament. So there is one ligament that is called stylomandibular ligament. So from these two parts, that is tip of the styloid process and stylomandibular ligament. That is from the styloid process to the angle of the mandible, there is one ligament. that is called stylomandibular ligament. These two structures, they are giving origin to the styloglossus muscle. And it is inserted to the side of the tongue. And the action of this styloglossus muscle, it retracts the tongue backwards and upwards and is antagonistic to the action of the genioglossus. The genioglossus, it pulls the tongue forwards. In that way, it is preventing the obstruction to the respiration. Here, the antagonistic this genioglossus muscle action is styloglossus. It tries to pull the tongue backwards and upwards. Okay, that is the action of the styloglossus. Next, another muscle, that is the palatoglossus. The palatoglossus muscle, it takes origin from the aponeurosis of the palate or palatine aponeurosis, under surface of the palatine aponeurosis, and passes downwards and forwards in front of the tonsillar fossa and cover of the palatoglossal arch. There is one arch, palatoglossal. From palate to the tongue, there is one arch that is called palatoglossal arch. Within the palatoglossal arch, this palatoglossus muscle present. And it is inserted to the side of the tongue in front of the sulcus tendinalis. It goes and it comes to the tongue, sides of the tongue, and it gets inserted to the in front of the sulcus terminalis. And action of this muscle is, it elevates the tongue and narrows the oropharyngeal isthmus. Isthmus means junction. The oropharyngeal junction, it is the muscle, and it narrows the oropharyngeal junction. With the help of this function, it is helping for the deglutition. It is the muscle helping for the deglutition. Here you can see, this is the tongue and this is the pharynx. Here this is the oropharyngeal junction. You can see here, this is the palatoglossus muscle. It is the aponeurosis of the palate, and it is taking origin from the aponeurosis of the palate. Then it is going down and forwards, and it is attached to the sides of the tongue. On both sides. Okay, this side also, this muscle. And this side, this is the muscle. Okay. Next, another, you can see here, this is the styloid process. This is the mastoid process. Just in front of the mastoid process, there is a bony prolongation. This is called styloid process. And here, this styloid process is providing origin to the styloglossus. And there is another ligament, that is stylomandibular ligament. From here to here, mandible, there is one ligament. That is the stylomandibular ligament. These two, they are providing origin to the styloglossus muscle. Okay, here also you can see, these are all the structures. This is the hyoglossus muscle. This is the genioglossus. Okay, these are all the different structures. And here, this is the styloglossus. From the styloid process to the side of the tongue, this is the styloglossus muscle. Okay. Next, if you take the transverse section of the tongue, these are all the different directional muscle fibers, skeletal muscle fibers. These are the, some are the vertical fibers, some are transverse fibers, some are longitudinal fibers. Like that, there are different directional muscle fibers. These are all the muscles, they are intrinsic muscles of the tongue. Okay, here also you can see. Next, coming to the nerve supply of the tongue. This is very, very important, nerve supply. Because it is receiving nerve supply and it is sending sensory nerves to the different structures. That is why the nerve supply of the tongue, it is a very important short answer. You must be very careful. All the muscles of the tongue are supplied by hypoglossal nerve. That is the somatomotor. Already sir explained about the what is somatomotor, what is vasomotor, and what is special sensory, what is general sensory, all these things. Here, the somatomotor means that is from the muscles of the tongue, because they are all made up of skeletal muscles. They are receiving nerve supply from the hypoglossal nerve, except the palatoglossus muscle. It is supplied by another nerve, that is accessory nerve. Accessory nerve via the pharyngeal plexus of nerves. Okay, the palatoglossus muscle is supplied by accessory nerve. The remaining all muscles of the tongue, they are receiving the motor nerve supply from the hypoglossal nerve. This is very, very important bit. Okay, if you go to the PC, this is the very important bit, that is except the palatoglossus muscle. And next, coming to the secretomotor fibers to the anterior lingual glands. Secretomotor fibers, the secretomotor fibers are coming from the there is a cauda tympani now through the lingual nerve. They are reaching the tongue to the anterior part. Next, vasomotor, that is the sympathetic nerves which surround the lingual artery. Vasomotor, they regulate the blood flow to the structures, that is by regulating the volume, the lumen of the blood vessels. That is why they are called vasomotor. Okay, next is the sensory supply of the tongue. This is very, very important. The sensory supply of the tongue, anterior 2/3 of the tongue, it is supplied by lingual nerve, that is general sensory, and it also supplied by special sensory, that is in the form of cauda tympani nerve of the facial nerve. Here, the cauda tympani nerve actually starts in the superior salivary nucleus of the pons. It passes through the facial nerve. Finally, it reaches the cauda tympani nerve and it reaches the tongue. Especially the anterior 2/3 of the tongue, the special sensory nerve is the cauda tympani. Cauda tympani nerve. The general sensory nerve is the lingual nerve. The general sensory is the lingual, and the special sensory, that is the taste. Special sensory is the cauda tympani nerve. It is a branch of the facial. That is the anterior 2/3. Next, coming to the posterior 1/3 of the tongue. The glassopharyngeal nerve is the nerve of the both, that is a special sensory and general sensory. That is at the same time, it is carrying both the sensations, that is a special, that is taste sensation of the posterior 1/3 and general sensation of the posterior 1/3 of the tongue. From valacula, there is a the posterior part, that is in two between, in between the median glossoepiglottic fold and lateral glossoepiglottic fold, there is a depression, that is called valacula. From the valacula, the internal laryngeal branches of the vagus nerve. Internal laryngeal branches of the vagus nerve, which is taking sensory function. Okay, these are all the differences between the nerve supply of different parts of the tongue. Because of this reason, the tongue nerve supply is very, very important in our examination point of view. They may ask for the short answer of 5 marks or 3 marks like that. Okay. Here you can see the diagrammatic representation. Here, this is the total motor. This is the motor supply. That is all the muscles of the tongue. They are supplied by hypoglossal nerve, except there is a 12th cranial nerve, except the palatoglossus muscle. It is supplied by the some other muscle, nerve. Okay. Next, coming to the sensory. This side represents the sensory. Here, this is the anterior 2/3 and this is the posterior 1/3. In between these two, this is the sulcus terminalis. Behind, in front of the some part of the sulcus terminalis, that is especially the valid papillae, circumvallate papillae, including circumvallate papillae and sulcus terminalis, and part of the tongue posterior to the circumvallate, that is the sulcus terminalis. All this area, it is supplied by the glassopharyngeal nerve. Glassopharyngeal nerve, that is both general and special sensory. And anterior 2/3, except the valid papillae. Except the valid papillae, it is supplied by the lingual nerve, that is the general sensory, and cauda tympani nerve, special sensory. Okay. And here, actually, in between these two areas, there is no clear-cut boundary. There is an overlapping of the sensory nerve. This is the overlapped area of the sensory nerve. And here the posterior part, that is by the vagus nerve. Okay, the vagus nerve. Next, coming to the arterial supply of the tongue. That is the artery, the chief artery of the tongue is the lingual artery. It is a branch of the external carotid artery. The lingual artery is a branch of the external carotid artery. It is the chief artery of the tongue. And apart from this lingual artery, tongue also receives blood supply from the dorsal lingual artery, supply the pharyngeal part, and arteria profunda linguae. That is also another artery, it also supplies to the tongue. And here, ascending palatine and tonsillar arteries, that is the branches of the facial artery, and ascending pharyngeal artery, it is a branch of the external carotid artery. And these are all the arteries they are supplying to the tongue. Next, the venous drainage of the tongue, the superficial and deep veins are there. And the superficial veins drains the deep inferior surface, accompanies the hypoglossal nerve and ends into the internal jugular vein. The deep veins, they drain the dorsal surface of the tongue, and also there also drains into the internal jugular vein. Next, coming to the other important part of the tongue, that is the lymphatic drainage. The lymphatic drainage of the tongue is very, very important clinically, because the tongue pathology is more common in India, especially people who are chewing, that is, pan and tobacco, okay, or Dravid, Rahul Dravid, okay. Here, this lymphatic drainage of the tongue is very, very important because of the cancer of the tongue is the most common disease in Indians, especially people who are who used to take gutkha, pan, and who used to chew tobacco. Okay, because of this reason, the lymphatic drainage of the tongue is very, very important. In our examination point of view also, they may ask for the short answer. Here, the lymphatics of the tongue, they are forming a fluxus, that is intramuscular fluxus and submucosal fluxus. They are from the fluxus. From these fluxus, there are lymphatic vessels, they start. And from these, all these lymphatic vessels, there are different areas of the tongue are supplying, drained into the different group of lymph nodes. Different groups of lymph nodes. You see what are the different group, that is areas of the tongue, and in which group they are drained. Here first you see the apical group. This is the apical group, and this is the marginal group, marginal, and this is the central part, and this is the dorsal. Like this, the lymphatic drainage of the tongue, it is divided into four parts. This is the apical part, this is the marginal part, and this is the central, and this is the dorsal. Okay, from all these areas, the lymphatics drains into different groups of lymph nodes. We see in detail. Okay, it drains the tip and frenulum of lingua. That is the apical group, it drains the lingua, means tongue. Frenulum of the lingua and tip of the tongue, and it terminates as follows. That is, some vessels pierce the mylohyoid and drain into submental lymph nodes, and a few directly into the jugulo-omohyoid lymph nodes, and some vessels drains into submandibular nodes after piercing the mylohyoid muscle, and a few into the jugulo-digastric lymph nodes. Jugulo-digastric lymph nodes. You see, in the apical area or tip of the tongue, it is only small area, but it is draining the wide, that is because the lymphatics from the tip of the tongue, they are going into different groups of the lymph nodes. That is why you see here this is the apical part, and it is going to the jugulo-omohyoid nodes, and it is also going submandibular group of lymph nodes. From here again it is going to jugulo-digastric nodes, and like this it is draining, and it also drains into the submental group of lymph nodes. Okay, like this. From this small area, the lymphatics are drained, are connected with the different groups of lymph nodes. Because of this reason, the tip of the tongue, lymphatic drainage of the tip of the tongue is very, very dangerous. Especially if the individual, if he develops cancer tip of the tongue, there is a chances of there is a metastasis of these cancerous lesions to different parts of the cervical group of lymph nodes. Cervical region lymph nodes. That is why it is most dangerous. Next, coming to the another set, that is a marginal set of lymph nodes. The vessels drain the side of the tongue in front of the sulcus terminalis and terminates as follows. Here, the marginal group of the lymph nodes, they drain the dorsum of the tongue, that is the sides of the tongue, in front of the sulcus terminalis. In front of the sulcus terminalis. And this is the area for the drainage of the marginal group of lymphatics. Next, you see from here, the some vessels drain into submandibular group of lymph nodes after piercing the mylohyoid muscle, and some vessels pass deep to the mylohyoid and drains into jugulo-digastric and jugulo-omohyoid nodes. These are the different groups of the nodes. Next, coming to the central group of lymph nodes, the vessels drain the dorsal surface of anterior two-thirds of the tongue in front of the valid papillae. papillae. You see here, this is the central group. Central, this is the marginal. Okay, this is the marginal, and this is the area central group of lymphatics, that is lymphatic vessels. Here, these central group of lymphatic vessels, they drain the dorsum of the tongue just in front of the valid papillae. Valid papillae. The big, you can see after seeing the development of the tongue, why the valid papillae are exempted in all aspects from the anterior thrusts of the tongue. We come to a conclusion. Okay, for the time being, you just remember, except the valid papillae, the central part of the tongue, it is drained by central group of lymph nodes. And that is most of the vessels drain into jugulodigastric and jugulohomohyoid nodes. A few vessels pierce the mylohyoid and drains into submandibular lymph nodes. Next, another group, that is the dorsal or basal set of lymph nodes. That is, it drains the posterior one-third of the tongue, including valid papillae. That is circumvallate, including circumvallate papillae, and behind the, that is the sulcus terminalis, and total part of the posterior one-third of the tongue, it is drained by dorsal set or basal set of lymphatics. That is, most of the vessels drain bilaterally into jugulodigastric nodes and are after piercing the pharyngeal wall, and on the vessels passes downwards behind the tongue, the hyoid bone pierces the thyrohyoid membrane and drains directly into jugulohomohyoid nodes. Okay, these are all the different groups of lymphatics which are draining the tongue. Next, coming to the, what is the peculiarity of the lymphatics of the tongue? That is very, very important, because the carcinoma of the tongue, it is the most common disease in oral pathology. And during this carcinoma of the tongue, the lymphatics are playing most important role in metastasizing the cancerous lesions. Because of this reason, it is having a peculiar. Lymphatics do not accompany the blood vessels. That is the first point. The lymphatics of the tongue, they are not accompanying the blood vessels. And in the middle of the tongue, a free dissociation takes place, and the lymphatics pass bilaterally. There is a dissociation of the lymphatics in the midline. And the tip of the tongue presents richest lymphatic drainage. A cancer affecting the tip spreads to all cervical lymph nodes of the both the sides. That is why the cancer of the tip of the tongue is the most dangerous area, because the metastasis may occur in all directions and all groups of the cervical. That is why this is very, very important, lymphatic drainage. Next, coming to the development of the tongue. This is also very, very important short answer. There is a mucous membrane of the tongue. First, how it develops. First, you see about the mucous membrane. It is developed from the endoderm of the floor of the pharynx. It is developed from the endoderm of the floor of the pharynx and is subdivided into anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third. That is the mucous membrane of the tongue. It is developed from the endoderm and it is divided into anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third. The anterior two-thirds are oral part of the tongue. Mucus, it develops from the, it is developed from the fusion of the two swellings, that is two lingual swellings. Lingual swellings of the first branchial arch. In the first branchial arch, there are two lingual swellings. Madam will discuss in embryology in detail about the what are the lingual swellings, how they appear, all these things we discuss later. Next, here the lingual swellings, they fuse together, and they are also fused with the another swelling, that is and from an unpaired swelling, that is the tuberculum impor, which appears between the first and second arches. That is so lingual swellings are from the first arch, branchial arch, and tuberculum impor is the from the second, first, in between the second and third branchial arches. These together, they form the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. Next, coming to the posterior one-third of the tongue, that is nothing but the pharyngeal part, is developed from a median elevation, the hypobronchial eminence. Which is formed by the fusion of the second, third, and fourth branchial arches. Composite development of mucosa mucous membrane is represented by its sensory nerve supply. Already we had seen sensory nerve supply of the tongue. It is having nerve supply from different nerves because of development of the tongue from different sources. Different sources. Because of this reason, it is receiving different nerves. Next, muscles of the tongue, how they develop. The muscles, the tongue muscles are developed from occipital myotome, which is formed by the fusion of four pre-cervical somites. It is a somites, that is the embryo, it is divided into different somites. From these somites, there are development of different structures. That is a four pre-cervical somites. They are participating in the formation of occipital myotome. And from these myotomes, the myotomes migrate forwards to invade the tongue along the epipericardial ridge, carrying its own nerve supply. Because of this reason only, the tongue muscles are supplied by the hypoglossal nerve. Because actually it is supplied to the back muscles. And because of this reason, these muscles, they are migrated forwards and they are also carrying its own nerve supply. This explains why hypoglossal nerve crosses superficial to both internal and external carotid arteries. Here, if you see in the neck, the hypoglossal nerve is the superficial most nerve. It goes superficial to the internal and external carotid arteries. Because these are the myotomes, occipital myotomes, they migrate like this. They migrate like this and they are carrying its own nerve supply. That is in the form of hypoglossal nerve. Next, the fibrous stoma develops from the mesoderm. This is the development of the tongue. That is the first mucous membrane, next is the muscles, and next is the fibrous stroma and muscles. All these things, that these are all the development of the tongue. Next, coming to the, what is the role of the tongue in different functions? That is, first you see about the role of the tongue in speech. That is, vowels are produced by the intrinsic muscles of the tongue, which produce different configuration of resonating chambers of each vowel. Okay, next, consonants are produced by intrinsic muscles of the tongue, so that the tongue is separated from the teeth, gums, or palate by a blast of expired air. Okay, these are the two important functions. That is, vowels are produced by the extrinsic muscles, and consonants are produced by the intrinsic muscles of the tongue. Next, role of tongue in the mastication. That is, the dorsal surface of the tongue becomes throw-like to receive the food. The tongue is twisted so that one margin is elevated and the other margin is depressed. This is done by the unilateral contraction of the styloglossus muscle. The styloglossus muscle, it helpful for the mastication in the form of depressing the tongue, one side of the tongue, and elevating the other side of the tongue. So, as a result, the food accumulates between the tongue margins of the masticatory teeth. Next, the tone of buccinator and muscles of the tongue permit mastication by teeth. Sudden contraction of buccinator pushes the masticated food from the margins of the teeth into the oral cavity. And the tongue undergoes repeated twisting movements to mix the masticated food with the saliva to convert into bolus. And the bolus, it goes into the posterior part. After that, there is a constriction of this oropharyngeal isthmus and it goes into the pharynx. Next, during deglutition, that is the role of the tongue during deglutition, the bolus is placed on the concave dorsal surface of the tongue behind the elevated lip. Therefore, the food is impressioned between the palate and the tongue. When the mylohyoid muscle contracts and hyoid bone moves forwards and upwards, the interval between the palate and the tongue is obliterated and the food slips backwards. And it goes, that is the process of deglutition. And next, coming to another important point related to the tongue, that is the congenital abnormalities. What are the congenital abnormalities of the tongue? That is due to different reasons. Different reasons, there is a chances for the due to genetic mutations or exposure of mother to teratogenic agents. It may lead to different congenital abnormalities. First one is the aglasia. Aglasia, that means complete absence of the tongue. And hemiglasia. Hemiglasia means half of the tongue developed and half of the tongue not developed. That is due to suppression of the one side lingual swellings. It may lead to hemiglasia. And next is the lingual thyroid. Lingual thyroid. Lingual thyroid. Here, actually, you can see here, this is the lingual thyroid. Actually, the thyroid initially develops in the posterior part of the tongue, and through the thyroglossal duct, it goes down and it settles at the neck. But in some occasions, there is no appearance of the thyroglossal duct. Thyroglossal duct, there is a failure of the appearance of the thyroglossal duct. In that occasions, the thyroid gland may be arrested in the posterior one third of the tongue. That is why it is a cause for the development of the lingual thyroid. Lingual thyroid. Okay. Next, another one is the thyroglossal cyst. Thyroglossal cyst. Here, you see, this is the, if the person develops thyroid and the tongue, this is the lingual thyroid. Lingual thyroid. And here another structure, another important clinical point, that is a thyroglossal cyst. Thyroglossal cyst. Here, usually this is the pathway of passage of the thyroid cells from the posterior one third of the tongue into the thyroid. In this way, they are going. Or after the function is over, this thyroglossal duct usually disappears. Usually disappears. In some occasions, there may be some part of the thyroglossal duct may be perceived. And in future, usually after birth, immediately after birth, there is no much abnormality. As the age advances, if the age of the child advances, they may develop a median swelling in between the symphysis mentae and the thyroid gland. In this area, there is a chances for the swelling, that is called thyroid cyst. Thyroglossal cyst. That is due to persistence of the thyroglossal duct, some part of the thyroglossal duct, and it may lead to development of thyroglossal cyst. That is another clinical condition. And next, come to the another one, tongue tie. Tongue tie. That is also called ankyloglasia. Ankyloglasia. Usually, what happens during development, the tongue, the inferior surface of the tongue is separated from the floor of the mouth by appearance of the sulcus. Okay, but in some part, usually the tongue is connected to the floor of the mouth with a thin layer of mucous membrane, that is called frenulum. Usually the frenulum is not extending up to the tip of the tongue. But in this occasion, this condition, the tip of the tongue is also connected with the frenulum of the tongue. Because of this reason, this is called tongue tie, or it is also called ankyloglasia. Ankyloglasia. That is the most important thing. Next, another important abnormality, that is a bifid tongue. Bifid tongue. We already know that is a tongue develops from the two lingual swellings. That is especially the anterior two thirds of the tongue. It develops from the two lingual swellings. That is right and left lingual swellings. And posterior part, it is from the tuberculum impar. And the posterior most part, that is different, hypobronchial eminence. Okay, here, usually there is a fusion between the two lingual swellings. It is not complete. The fusion between the two lingual swellings is not complete. It leads to development of bifid tongue. The bifid tongue, it is the most common feature of the snakes. But here, in the human beings, the bifid tongue is not normal because it is due to failure of the fusion of the lingual swellings may lead to the development of the bifid tongue. That is due to some teratogenic agents during the early months of pregnancy. Okay, that is the thing. Next, here our secrets, it reveals the tongue. Okay, your tongue reveals your secrets, health secrets, especially health secrets. Suppose if you see there are fissures on the tongue, that means there is a chances for the person may be suffering from psoriasis. Okay, these are all the fissures on the tongue. And if you take a white creamy layer, that is patches of the white creamy layer, and this is the white patch or the tongue, and it is due, mostly it is due to candidiasis, and this oral candidiasis is the most important clinical feature of the people who are having low immunity levels, especially immunocompromised patients, especially the AIDS patients, people who are suffering with HIV, and if there are developed AIDS, this is the most common feature, that is the lingual candidiasis or oral candidiasis. Oral candidiasis is the most common feature in the people who are having the compromised immune system. Okay, that is especially the AIDS, and it is also common in uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. Uncontrolled diabetes mellitus people, they are also having the low resistance. In that occasion, there is also chances for the development of oral candidiasis. And it is also more common in lactating babies. Lactating babies, suppose the mother is not taking proper care about her breast while feeding, there is a chances for the development of oral thrush, which is also called oral thrush or oral candidiasis in the lactating babies. That is the white patch. Next, coming to the another muscle, another abnormality, that is the smoothness of the tongue. That is the disappearance of the papillae and all the irregularities of the tongue. That is due to atrophic glossitis. Atrophic glossitis, that is also one of the clinical condition. And another one, bright red tongue. Bright red tongue, that is mostly it is due to deficiency, vitamin B12 deficiency. And it is more common, you can observe in the clinicals, it is more common in people who receive long-term antibiotics. Long-term antibiotics and for many days hospitalized people and who won't receive proper nutritious diet, there is a chances for the development of this condition. That is a bright redness of the tongue. That is called glossitis. Glossitis, that is one of the symptoms of the vitamin B12 deficiency. B12 deficiency. Next is the thick yellow coating of the tongue. That is due to, mostly this is due to bacterial infection of the GIT. Bacterial infection of the GIT. This is the most common cause. And next is the black and hairy, and it is due to poor hygiene. And next is the painless bumps. Painless bumps over the tongue, and the sides of the tongue are the, or the dorsal surface of the tongue. These are the most dangerous clinical conditions. There is in the future, there is a chances for the development of the carcinoma of the carcinoma of the tongue. And another one, sores. That is a oral, there is a tongue sores. That is, these are all painful conditions. Mostly these are due to vitamin deficiency, or sometimes maybe due to hormonal imbalance. Hormonal imbalance. This is the most common cause for the oral sores. Oral sores. Okay, these are by just by seeing with the tongue of the individual, or you can also estimate the, if the tongue is pale, the person may be anemic. The person may be anemic. That is why most of the doctors, when the patient comes to cleaning, they used to observe the inspect the tongue of the individual. That is why the tongue is very, very important. Okay, this is the hyoid bone. Here, this is the lesser carno, this is the greater carno, and this is the body of the hyoid bone. Okay, next, here, this is the today our class, that is tongue, it is clinically and the examination point of view also, it is very, very important, because if you see, they may ask for the essay question, that is about, write about the tongue in detail about the, that is the structure, relations, muscles, nerve supply, development, and applied aspect. Or they may ask for the individual questions, that is the short answers, that is the nerve supply of the tongue, they may ask, lymphatic drainage of the tongue, they may ask, and hyoglossus muscle, they may ask, genioglossus muscle, and like that, that is why this tongue is very, very, and congenital abnormalities of the tongue is also very, very common and important. Okay, that is the thing. Okay, thank you.
Nice.